Well, thanks everybody for being here on a 4th of July weekend. All right, so as we start, I want to bring some things to your attention. So I know some of you in here listen online to Pastor Jack Hibbs from Calvary Chapel, Chino Hills. Okay, so I didn't write him here, but he's my home church, okay? But some other good sources, you can look up, find them on the internet, Olive Tree Ministries with Jan Markell. So she does a series of biblical thoughts along with what's happening in the world today. Tremendous resource, and all her guests that she has really will give you some insight in what's going on in the world. Just amazing. She's also Jewish. She's a Jewish Christian, and she's been doing this for years, so she's amazing. Okay? We're going to talk about today, just briefly, David Barton. He's written a lot of books. He's spoken in the church here, and he's a historian. David Barton probably has more. I'd let him confirm this, but if he doesn't have the most, he has one of the most largest collections in his library of original documents of the founding of America. Okay? So, again, you can go online and find his stuff, but one book that I would highly recommend is America's Godly Heritage. It's very small, so you know you can get through it pretty quick. But again, excellent resource. And then, this is available in our church. I've given so many of these away, I ran out and I had to buy a new one today. 100 Bible Verses That Made America by Robert Morgan. Again, that's it right here. Fantastic resource. Butch, I think you have that, right?
I should check it out in the library here.
No, you didn't buy it.
I'll buy it.
Now, lastly, I'm not suggesting you buy this. This is written by Klaus Schwab. He's the executive clown for the World Economic Forum. And he's truly
dangerous.
Dangerous. Yes. So this is his book, and it's interesting because, yes, when I was involved with the World Economic Forum, I arranged many meetings, I was in many meetings, I stood in government relations. And what they say in here, what he says in here, it's the best spin I've ever heard. How they candy coat stuff for an ultimate agenda. Okay, so this is really philosophy behind what's going to be responsible for the great reset in the world. And I know we talked about that. Did you get a book, by the way, this one?
I did.
Okay.
Say the name of that one.
This one is The Great Narrative for a Better Future. Klaus Schwab. So just some good resources. Doctor, do you happen to be in surgery anytime before 2 today? We might be done by then.
Yeah.
Okay. Last thing, one of the things I'm going to talk about, some of the things taking place, but do you all know who Michelle Bachmann is?
Yes.
Okay. She's been following this very close. The United Nations, one of their arms is the WHO, World Health Organization. There's a movement going on right now that in May of 2024, there will be a vote in the United States, Congress and Senate, unless Biden does an executive order to overrule him. But they're preparing to give our sovereignty away based on health crisis, health situations, to where the WHO will control world government, okay, the world. Things are happening fast. Within the past 3 or 4 weeks, the WHO appointed somebody in charge of the World Health Organization. He's from North Korea. Now, does this make sense? So it kind of tells you what's some things taking place. So more to come on that. All right, so we're going to start out here on America's founding, a godly heritage. There we go. So I'm not going to get into a lot of detailed history, just bullet points, because I'm afraid Paul would find something wrong.
He probably would.
So again, it's not taught in schools today, and it started probably in the 60s, getting away from proof points that the U.S. was founded on Christian principles. Again, I mentioned David Barton, with thousands of documents. So he's the founder of Wall Builders, and he goes around describing this. But without any question at all, America was blessed by God. It was founded on the Christian, Judeo-Christian principles. So looking at the July 2nd, 1776, was the founding fathers were at the Continental Congress. So this is where they voted. Many of these people were very high up in the British government when they lived in England. They voted to basically go to war, separate from England. It was announced to the public on July the 8th. And at that time, it's in the historical records that all the people involved in the Continental Congress, founders of this country, went out and rang the bell. There's two reasons to ring the bell. One, it's to get attention from the community, so everybody comes and they hear the proclamation. Number two, they rang it to acknowledge that they were proclaiming liberty. Now, on the Liberty Bell, has anybody seen the Liberty Bell? Has anybody been there?
Yes.
Oh, fantastic. So you recognize the ringing of the bell, proclaiming liberty. Well, it comes from Leviticus 25:10. So that's kind of, to me, that's kind of exciting. And then preparing for the conflict, I mean, there's a lot of names. You can mention Washington, Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin. I just put a few here: Patrick Henry, John Adams, John Jay. Now, the list goes on, Benjamin Franklin, okay? But the thing that's really neat to understand is that this Continental Congress, where they were putting together this proclamation to separate from England, they opened with a prayer by Reverend Jacob, how do you pronounce his name? You see? And so not only did they open up with a prayer, so he was with the Christ Church, which there's some debate, but between 12 and 15 of our founding fathers attended this church, and many, more than attended the church, were buried at this church cemetery. But they opened the Continental Congress with reading four chapters in the Bible. And so, you know, when there's a crisis, you're preparing for a war. You're preparing to go on vacation. You know, you're packing, you're trying to catch your flight. You don't really spend a lot of time in Bible study reading four chapters, discussing it, you know, with the pastor there. They did it. So that, to me, that's, again, another recognition that they were really trying to do the right thing. Now, talking about some of the founding fathers, I'm going to talk about two here. Obviously, George Washington is a big one. I'm not going to talk about him. John Locke. John Locke was really, his claim to fame was the Second Treaties of the Government. So with this really, some of the major points, he was a philosopher, but some of the major points around this treaties that he wrote was sovereignty resides with the people. So again, he was in there justifying Americans to go to battle with England and separate from England. So one of his quotes, when a government becomes so oppressive and tyrannical that there no longer remains any legal remedy for citizens, they can appeal to heaven and then resist the tyrannical government. So, farther in his justification there that he was giving the people in the Congress that they could bring to their fellow citizens was taken out of the Bible. He does talk about three natural rights, and these rights are God-given rights: life, liberty, and property. And he also favored a representative government, so a republic, not the benevolent or dictatorship that they were seeing in England. Next one here, John Adams. So he's considered the leader of the movement for independence. I didn't bring it, but books on his life are truly amazing. He was definitely a Christian. But one of his philosophies that he really wanted to get into the Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, was that our government, and Paul will like this, was based on law, the rule of law, instead of the rule of people. What he was worried about, too, is making sure the branches of government were separated. So basically, the passions of the day would not govern the direction of the country. So I think, as we can see today, things have kind of changed to where Supreme Court makes a ruling and the public, with their passions, go, oh, that's a bad ruling. We can't trust the court. So, you know, so you can see, though, this was our founding. Later on, one of the letters that he wrote was to Thomas Jefferson, again, acknowledging that the principles of Christianity were the foundation of us going to war with England and separating from England. So again, looking at our biblical heritage, in, what's the date, 1782, there was a printer that, he was in Philadelphia, that went to Congress, and he justified printing the American Bible in English, the first printing of an English Bible in the United States. And the way he defended this at the Congress was he wanted to make the Bible part of the integrated curriculum for our schools, far removed from what we see today. But yeah, so this is what happened. So it was approved, and he started printing. And this picture is actually from David Barton's collection. He has one of the original Bibles, the one on the right. George Washington, in the American-French and Indian War, also acknowledged that our success was by direct intervention of God. This is in the documents, quite a few documents. I just wanted, but he was very outspoken about this. Two, he also admitted that he was surprised he was alive if it wasn't for the intervention of Providence. And so that's the word back then they used for God. Okay? All right. Has anybody ever seen one of these? You do? Okay, great. So back during the time of the Revolution, this became the flag of the colonies. They needed a flag after, you know, the colonies formed into their nation that was breaking away from England, basically, so their militaries could tell the difference between who they were fighting with. Because these were people that came from all over the country. So this was the flag. So remember one of the things I mentioned about Locke earlier, one of our founders. Well, that's where this came from. An appeal to heaven.
Thank you.
Before we go on, I thought it would be good for us and Cynthia, I'm going to have you lead the reading of the verse.
Okay. These things I have spoken to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation. Take courage. I have overcome the world.
Okay, yeah, so here.
Okay, Deuteronomy 31:6.
31:6, yes.
Be strong and courageous. Do not fear, for you are better than them. For it is the Lord your God who goes with you. He will not leave you or forsake you.
So Butch, I thought we'd have something a little positive before we move on. All right, here, we're not going to read the 2 Peter 3, but it's describing the coming day of the Lord. And again, acknowledging that the world, we're currently right now in the church age, which roughly started around Pentecost, and will end during the tribulation, which is an exciting part that we will be part of that. The rapture, as you mentioned earlier, that's our prize, where we will meet him in the air. So now, looking at this America today, where we come from, so we saw that the America was founded on these Judeo-Christian biblical principles. I forget the date, but how long ago was it that we pulled the Bible out of school? We pulled paradise schools. So, kind of the start of a downslide for America. What are we seeing today as the stage is being set? So the thought here is, we won't have a wonderful, trouble-free life, and then all of a sudden, there's a rapture, and then the tribulation starts. There's a setting of the table, birth pains, I think, that the Bible refers to it as. So let's look at some of the things taking place now. Climate deviation is from the norm. So, yes, you're hearing about climate change, global warming, everything taking place. I've worked with six global, they're considered global experts, working for the three largest engineering companies in the world that build everything. One of them built the Hoover Dam, their company's Bechtel. Then we have Fluor, and I think, John, you're familiar with some of these too.
Oh, yeah.
These scientists, they are talking about the Earth's magnetic poles are moving, and anywhere from 50 to 100 feet a year. And as these poles move, going back in history, scientists have seen where there's been polar shifts. So they actually believe this is part of the climate deviation, which ties into the second law of thermodynamics, where things decay over time. Interesting, before the fall in Eden, in a perfect world, there was no second law of thermodynamics. People were dying, animals were dying, plants were dying, right? So it was a perfect world. But now we're seeing stage being set, population growth. The reason this is a problem, World Economic Forum, and one of their agendas, they are working toward, Bill Gates is part of this, they're working toward limiting and downsizing the global population. We have today between 7 and 8 billion people on the Earth. Their number, whether they achieve or not, is 2 billion. Something has to happen. We're seeing today armed groups in conflicts globally. There's 193 countries in the world acknowledged by the United Nations. Anybody guess here how many armed conflicts are around the world today? The number's about 80. So almost half. We're seeing anti-Semitism growing like we haven't seen for years. Government instabilities globally, and I have a chart on that. I'll show you that. We're seeing globally, not just the U.S., globally we're seeing drought, water scarcity. The African nations are just being hammered right now. South America, same thing. And what happens in these countries will also affect us here eventually. Food shortages, yeah, the Ukraine war is terrible. They were kind of a breadbasket for Europe when it comes to food growth. Well, U.S. food basket for the world. We haven't seen the starvation here, the lack of food, like a lot of nations. But I've got a chart to show you something there. Pestilence, Australia, South America, Africa, parts of the United States, seeing pestilence like they've never seen before. In New York City this week, they were having an infestation of bugs that they've never seen before. A lot of it's being driven by smoke, fires in Canada, disease and natural disasters. So in natural disasters, in the Bible, there's a, it talks about an increase, let's say, in earthquakes. Coming from California, I'm well aware of earthquakes. I've been following them since 1972. And this is a live app showing earthquakes. Showing live earthquakes. This is live to the minute. Bottom line is I can take this data and put it in an Excel spreadsheet and chart it. Basically, earthquakes have been increasing at a rapid rate. So, yeah. So there you're looking at Southeast Asia up through China. If you move the screen, Butch, you can see other parts of the world. But yeah, this is live. This is not repeating. This is live. Right now, yes. It's constant. So our Earth, the crust of our Earth is shifting constantly. So, you know, so during the tribulation, who's to say this is not going to get worse? Okay.
But if we just get rid of fossil fuels all the time, carry on war, we're okay.
Thank you, Butch. I appreciate it. Yeah, that'll work. And we'll talk about Al Gore in a minute. Crisis creation. That's happening. There's economic disruption, both globally and domestically in the U.S. I think every day you turn on the news, you hear about fear of the stock market crash, banks going under. So, you know, this is impacting the world, and it's also impacting here. Europe's in bad shape, by the way. Global military builds up. So, countries of the world, I don't care if it's Saudi Arabia, Ethiopia, obviously Russia and China, England, all these countries, they're increasing their military buildup in Japan fast as you can imagine right now. Meanwhile, in the U.S., what are we focusing on? Pronouns. All right. It doesn't bode well, honestly. Yes, wars, rumors of wars, wokeism, invasive technology advancement. So yes, we've described artificial intelligence, AI. And the world's on this path. And what is the administration here and a lot of people in the corporate industry want to do is limit our growth of AI because they're scared it's going to take us over, which at some point the Antichrist could use that technology or something similar to do the same thing. But what happens if we limit our research and development and not keep up with the world? It's going to weaken us. Okay? So that is actually taking place right now. So again, creating crisis. Mobility. Has anybody in here heard of the 15-minute city? So one of the agenda items for the World Economic Forum, and it is being pushed around the world, but really with a focus on America, is to limit your mobility. Limit your mobility within 15 minutes of where you live. So anybody have any Vietnamese friends in here? Maybe some of you ladies, when you have nails done, you put the Vietnamese So what the communists do in the adversity form, this is typical for every place communism and socialism has taken over. They, first thing they do, they limit the population's mobility so they can isolate them. Next thing they do, they set up... That's true. Then they come into neighborhoods, my neighborhood, to re-educate the population. This is where they tell individuals that you will be reported and train your neighbor if you hear your neighbor talking against the government. If you hear your father or mother talking against the government. So get people to distrust each other. And it's all part of this mobility, limiting transportation. So right now in America, our energy grid, nationwide, we're at capacity. We have not even 2% extra. And kind of what's happening with these clean energy wind farms and solar farms is putting into our system, wind alone right now is about 12% of the system in America. Solar is about 3%. Well, it's putting this energy back in the grid for our power plants, whether they were natural gas or coal-fired power plants. When they were designed to run 96 to 100% all the time. They were not designed like a refinery to be able to scale down on a daily basis. When wind and solar are prominent in the daytime, so the idea would be to scale these, our big primary plants down, 70%. They can't do it. So, because of the greenies and this climate stuff, a lot of our plants were shut down. We have no capacity. So now, when you start buying electric cars, all of a sudden you can't charge because we have a shortage of electricity, and also it's going to limit your mobility. So when you get into the hallways of the World Economic Forum, they're talking about this. This is part of their plan. The nuclear family, holy smokes, there's an attack on that. You know, COVID was a good thing because a lot of parents were able to see what the schools were teaching. Right? We had no idea. And shame on us. Right? Since the 60s, the revolution taking place there from the hippies getting into society, and now these people are older, controlling curriculum in schools. It's weakening America and our society. Aren't you glad we read those verses to begin with? So again, we're it looks like America, the stage is being set, not just for America, but for the world to come under a one world government. But America, yeah, we're the target. So if you see the picture there, the two men, the one on the right, that's Aschbach. He was a professor in Germany. His dad was a Nazi. It's totally record. The other guy, you think Klaus Schwab is evil. The other guy's even worse, Harari. He's made some statements. See the headline here? World Economic Forum calls for AI to rewrite the Bible to create religions that are actually correct. Alright, so this is going on in some of those hallways of the World Economic Forum. Every day they're looking at something to implement their, you'll see their Agenda 21, we're now on Agenda 2030. Something that happened that delayed their plan for Agenda 21 was Trump. Metrics. designing the cities. It's the cities. You will end up being happy. You've heard probably that expression, that's from Carl Schwab, quote. And you get what you pay for. So can you imagine driving to your kids or grandkids' house and paying by the mile? So tollways, all wherever you go, but not just tollways, this would be obvious, but this is part of that. People want nothing to happen. This one here, a little genuine connection. It sounds good. They spin it, market it right. That distance is danger. No, they don't want people to be distant. They want people to be congregated in these small cities, 15-minute cities, where they can manage and control them. So, again, this agenda, 21 was the book that I had, okay? It's about the stick.
Any time the left uses the term reimagine, I'd be very afraid.
Yeah.
At least they want to change.
Absolutely. And not for the better. No. Not with a Christian, Christ-based perspective.
I have a question.
Yes.
But it was something to the effect of, now that they're getting this new world religion going and the new Bible, that something about re-education camps and that they're building them in rural areas massive throughout the United States. Have you seen anything, or has anyone else seen anything about that? Of course, they're not calling it that. They're calling it distribution centers or something.
I'm not in the U.S. yet, but during COVID, there were some countries that did under the auspices that it was for the benefit of society, and that's the term. So with the under Agenda 21, one of their things was they pick people or countries to go to an extreme just to see how much people can handle, who they can get away with. So I don't know if you recall, this was early during COVID. President Trump had given a talk, and they turned it over to this woman called Dr. Scarfoot, it's how he breaks. She made a comment, she slipped, she made a comment that we, not me in the U.S. government, we were surprised how compliant Americans were to shut down, to stay home, to do everything they asked. So it's very telling. So she is one of the development people within the World Economic Forum. Okay. So again, the target is the weekend America, because it's been acknowledged that a strong America without faith in God is a challenge. We're holding things up. That's why they were not happy with Trump. So here, the World Economic Forum, they have the people that are members of this, you have politicians from 182 countries, 181 countries in the world, but there's 193 acknowledged. So these are the leaders of countries. And they have CEOs from major corporations. I don't know how many of you had retirement programs with companies you might have worked for in the past. A lot of them are managed by BlackRock. BlackRock's one of the largest in the world. One of the financial advisors for the World Economic Forum. Okay. This is a data point. As I said, politicians and corporate executives. Corporate executives are getting on board with the World Economic Forum that you cannot imagine, because they all want to be part of the club.
It's part of BlackRock's strategy, though.
Yeah, absolutely.
If I'm going to be here at the second place instead of first, okay, never
mind. So, they need funding, and that's where they get their funding, is through BlackRock and other institutions like that to put these dick things out there for them on their spotlight.
Yeah, so a while back I mentioned the ESG score. Environmental, social, and governance. I've already asked that. So these companies are having to comply, and these CEOs are having to do it because there's something in it for them. But what's happening is companies need money, they need loans from banks to increase and build more capital projects, to expand their plants, to develop new products. These companies aren't getting loans anymore unless they have a positive ESG score.
Sure, we did.
They're going to reduce their carbon footprint by 2030, 2040, you know, whatever the number. And if they're in the things that they're supporting. So, again, corporations, out of a need to survive and get this money from banks and institutions, they're complying and their products go for it. There is, see on the right there, that's from my LinkedIn mailbox that I get. And the World Economic Forum is advertising for young people. This is all part of a program to re-educate. So it's real. This is a real deal here. So they're looking for youth. So let's look at some people that have gone through that program. And this was obviously years ago. Oops. What happened?
I just made it bigger. A little bit bigger.
Yeah.
Hey, Don, so they got the ESG, but also there's the CEI.
Yes.
And so these companies, within, you know, people think, well, we've got a target and then, you know, on Budweiser's report, they think, oh, they really screwed up. Actually, that improved their CEI, their corporate equity index, by pushing transgenders and all that stuff.
Yes.
So, you know, they might have lost some customers, but they improved their standing with these banks and look at CEI scores.
Yep, you're exactly right.
And so, one of the acronyms, the DEI, mm-hmm. Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion.
Mm-hmm.
What I find interesting about that is DEI is Latin for God, and that is their God, DEI.
Oh, interesting. I didn't think about that. Yeah. Great point. Great point. Are we back? Oh, man, good. Butch, you're good.
I'm trying to get it to where you can see it.
So, look at some people, though. I mean, this list is huge, but I just listed a few people that went through the Young Global Leaders Program, which is what that advertisement is for, is to get people to start being re-educated in this program. Biden was in the 90s, not 1995. He was considered by Klaus Schwab as one of his top students. Trudeau, you know, are in Canada. That's not surprising, because, you know, during COVID, when all the truck drivers went to Montreal, he had influence on their bank accounts, still does. Macron from France, so the last major company I was with, did government relations with and ran an automation division, was French. So I'm well aware of French and their ESG and their, all this stuff. Things are crazy. Corporate execs, academia is on board with this, hook, line, and sinker. And then through these recruiting for young global leaders, they're getting normal society for this to be normal. So the young global leaders, they're doing this globally. In the United States, there are 39 re-education sites that World Economic Forum has set up. So it's here. It's here in America. So again, the target is for us to be weakened, and some of the plan is to establish one world government. World Economic Forum says, for the good of society, establishment of a digital currency. Well, COVID started this ball moving a little faster. Europe was already involved, but now the U.S. has put it in play. And again, for the good of society, monitoring purchases. So, controlling what you can buy. It's the direction they're going. It's for the good of society. Don't forget that. Establish a correct religion, which I already told you what they want to use AI for, to rewrite the craft the Bible that is correct. Elimination of the nuclear family. They found in the U.S. was probably, U.S. and Latin America, they found that the nuclear family is probably the strongest. Talking about that, in America, we came in America, you know, we used to send missionaries all over the world. We were number one country for missionaries outside sending them outside the U.S. Latin America is now number one, meaning Mexico, right? In Mexico. More missionaries than they are. Should tell us something. Elimination of God-fearing, so this new religion, whatever they want to try to create, the false prophet, I mean, it's all lined up. Borders, the redistribution of wealth. They don't want borders, so part of their reset that he had mentioned is to break down the walls between the countries. So everybody is equal, but some will be more equal than others.
Okay.
So, again, that's why I wanted to read those verses earlier. So how will this be accomplished? They're crafting a crisis, absolutely. So, sorry, I took this out of my workbook when I was in one of the meetings. This is the interaction play map for the crisis that we are going to start seeing. There's going to be more and more, and they're going to be more extreme and more extreme. So you'll see, right in the very center, climate action. They figured out that they can get the youth to believe in a new religion of climate for urban nature, okay? But, food crisis, human or environmental disasters, infectious diseases. So this is all in their playbook to develop. And we're already seeing some of this take place. So again, setting the stage for crisis. So remember, 193 countries acknowledged by the United Nations, is actually a couple more. There's some interesting political dynamics around it. So 80 conflicts. If you look at all the colored area that's not white, that's where there's active wars going on. And it's not just, this is not something that's a 7-day war. No. These are wars that have been going on for a long time. Something interesting, a group that continues to collect information on this, look for Israel is, they don't have it highlighted. Right now there's between Iran and Israel, it's getting pretty hot. Fragility, the global impact. So why will countries and governments and people follow some of these things leading to the beast, the Antichrist, what they try to do? This is the Global Fragility Index. This is data within the past 3 months. Basically, if you're not green or blue, you have a problem. So you can see the world's in trouble. America alone, this is our latest map for drought. Apparently it's wheat and corn and some other things that we grow primarily from Utah all the way through Nebraska, Iowa. They're projecting 50% harvest this year from normal. Rest of the world, similar. So, again, what do we know about what will take place after the rapture or leading up to the tribulation? We know that there will be a one-world government that will control society, what we can buy and sell. We know that there will be increasing apostasy in the church and many false Christs. So apostasy in the church. Anybody ever listen to Reverend Pastor Andy Stanley, who passed away recently? Anybody ever?
Charles.
Oh, I'm sorry, Charles Stanley. Anybody ever listen to his son?
No.
Yes.
No.
I know.
Well, when Andy Stanley, his son, says we don't need to study the Old Testament, it doesn't apply today, and he goes on with teachings like that, that's a problem. Efforts to weaken the U.S. are in many ways. And we are no longer considered on, polls have been taken at the United Nations, we're not considered a Christian nation anymore from polls taken in the U.S. And this is how I meet with these global dignitaries, whatever, they don't look at us as Christian anymore either.
Especially,
well, they look at us as a great Satan because they see our lifestyle. They see our morals. And, you know, Muslims hate to say it. Five times a day, they're down praying on their knees. I felt the most safe traveling to communist and Muslim countries my whole life. Japan's probably the exception. They're safer because they enforce the laws. So, yeah, it's amazing. And then America condoning the killing or abortion and mutilation of babies and children. Man, I would not want to be somebody involved in that during judgment. So this is a quote from Ruth Bell Graham, somebody associated with Billy Graham. If God doesn't soon bring judgment upon America, he'll have to go back and apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah. So the farther we get from God as a nation, the more the world spirals out of control. There is no perceived global leader right now. Why will the world give up their sovereignty, give their loyalty away? Because somebody that shows up with all the answers. The Antichrist. But is there hope? There is hope. You know, we look at how many times in the Old Testament did Israel fall away from the Lord, fell on their knees and repented, and the Lord forgave them, blessed them. So that's what we need to do in this country. You know, Jonah and Nineveh. I mean, Nineveh was evil, and they repented. So there is hope here. But America must repent and acknowledge Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Last one, Butch. So what can we do?
Nineveh, 100 years later, was back in its old ways, and I think that's amazing. Anyway, it didn't last forever.
No. And Israel kept falling back into idolatry, depending on the leaders they had at the time, too. So we need to stay in God's Word. So in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. We need to stay in His Word. We need to pray with a sense of urgency. Absolutely. We have some prayer warriors in here. Yeah, we all need to become prayer warriors. And again, the Great Commission, we need to bring His Word. We need to bring God to our friends, family, relatives, and those unsaved with this Great Commission. And then lastly, seriously, vote for godly leaders and pray for the leaders we have. Boy, they, absolutely. So think of it this way, on a positive aspect, things aren't falling apart. They're falling in place. And we know the end of the story. You know, God is in control. And Butch, that's it, and happy 4th of July. Thank you, guys.